Right, so good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. My first time speaking in Denmark. And I'll share through that presentation some examples of what we've done with investments in robotic companies. And hopefully, you'll find some useful things. So yeah, the title of the presentation is Scaling to Success for Robotic Startups. Probably through the other presentations earlier, you heard some successes, but there's also a lot of challenges and a lot of failures in that sector. So before I get started with the actual examples, let me just introduce our company. So HAX is an investment company. That's the hardware branch of a fund called SOSV. We're a global early stage fund focused on deep tech. We have over 700 investments in startups. We manage about $400 million. We actually have a new fund coming up. HAX is the hardware branch as part of this fund. There's also other branches, which I won't talk about today. We typically invest the very first check in startups between $100,000 and $250,000. And we've done about 200 investments in the hardware space, and about 10-15% of that is in robotics, so it's about 20-30 companies. Initially, we started with a lot of consumer type of products, but recently we switched quite massively to B2B, and you probably understand why, because, well, B2B clients have more money, they calculate ROI much better than consumers, and there's a giant industry that need to transform, and many of them are resorting to new technologies. So what's a little bit special about us is that we actually do a lot of work with China. We have a big office in Shenzhen, and we bring the startups we invest in to our Shenzhen office for several months to work with our team there so that they can learn how to use the supply chain to iterate on prototypes and go really fast to manufacturing and to scale. We have a second stage of our support program, which is San Francisco, to help find investment, to help find customers, and also with support toward marketing and scale. As about myself, I spent most of my working life in Asia, quite a lot of it in China, the past 5 years with HAX, including 4 years in Shenzhen and Hong Kong. Recently, I'm more in Europe for different reasons, but we are basically extremely active. We're the first accelerator program focusing exclusively on hardware when we started 6 years ago. So I'm going to details, my contacts are here. So I'll start with a little quiz to see what kind of an audience I have here regarding robotics and hardware knowledge. So which Danish robotics companies were acquired for over $100 million? Anybody knows? Yes?
Universal,
that's the first one. Second one? Mia, that's right. Right, those two guys, so you can see them in the show. They did really well. So Universal Robots, 285 million, Mia, 148. What's kind of interesting when I looked into, so I was very surprised to see that two big robotic companies came out of Denmark, and so I wanted to know more about that. I looked into the details. I found Universal Robots actually kind of a little bit oldish company, founded in 2005. Then acquired about 10 years later by Teradyne in the US. The revenue grew steadily as soon as they launched their product, doing quite well. But what I also noticed that it took them 3 years to release the first product. I also noticed that they sold for about 4 times the revenue for that year. So those are kind of interesting markers in terms of what kind of growth, what kind of scale, what kind of exits you can achieve. As for me, they were a lot faster. Founded in 2013, acquired 5 years later, so they did really well. Second question, which robot pet just got banned on the market? Robot pet, any idea? No.
Aibo.
Aibo, that's right. Yeah, Aibo, 99. Sony released Aibo, sold 150,000 units in 7 years, and discontinued. They just relaunched the new Aibo, and what's interesting is that it's kind of a vision of the future, but when you look at actual figures or numbers, it's actually not that great. It's not a great business at all. But it's still part of the psyche in terms of, oh, this is the future. But it's not a business. It's not a good business yet. It's really more demonstration of technology. Third question, which robotics companies were acquired by SoftBank?
Aldebaran.
Aldebaran? Oh, old-timer here. Okay. Maybe this one, Boston Dynamics. They acquired it from Google. Because Google didn't quite find what to do with it. Super exciting, everybody saw the videos online. Incredible technology. Market-wise, more questionable. What to do with that? Not sure. Very expensive. They also acquired, as part of the package, a Japanese company called Shaft. They have this kind of an interstellar-looking robot. That's actually pretty cool. And then for old-timers, like myself, or this gentleman over there, you have Aldebaran, a French company that got acquired for $100 million quite a few years ago. You probably saw these Pepper robots in virtual places, which at that time was probably a great idea, a great technology, but still hasn't really found a good market aside from, you know, greeting customers and holding an iPad. Number four, what is the number one home robotics company in the world? Any idea, yes?
iRobot, the vacuum cleaner?
That's right. That's right, iRobot, favorite of cats. So iRobot is today still the biggest robotic, consumer robotics company in the world. It's a very old company, started in 90, did a lot of military contracts, finally released the Roomba in 2002, that's, you know, over 15 years ago. Then, you know, grew their sales, selling about probably a couple of million units a year now. They have a new model, just came out, hands-free cleaning, permanent maps, you can control it with Alexa, the robot plus the base, $1,000. Not cheap. But what's interesting is that a few months ago, if I had asked the same question, the answer would have been different. Because there was this other company called Ecovacs. Heard of it? No. Chinese company. Doing broad range of products for floor, windows, on telepresence, all sorts of things. This is the market valuation of those two companies just a few days ago. Ecovacs just went down a little bit on iRobot surged, but a few months ago it was the opposite. So the biggest consumer robotics company a few months ago was Chinese. Nobody knows about it outside China. Okay, so you've still got that one right. How about this one? Which robotic startups are valued over $1 billion? Also called unicorns, yes?
Pizza delivery robot, the last system.
Pizza delivery robots, okay, yeah.
What?
Zoom, maybe?
Is that the name? There's
one like that, yeah. Any other? Okay, so it's not so clear, right? So, okay, if you include the IPO companies, which are not technically unicorns, of course, iRobot, Ecovacs. How about Cyberdyne, the one top right, exoskeleton company from Japan? Kuka, you know, got acquired now by Meidu from China. But private companies, you have Ninebot that actually acquired Segway and makes this little self-balancing robot transportation vehicle, which is kind of the evolution of Segway. DJI, arguably a robot. Ubitech, they do consumer robots for education, like this little guy over there. Carbon 3D, Desktop Metal, arguably robots, make kind of advanced 3D printers. The ones in red are Chinese companies. And now the question is probably most difficult. Which are the next robotic unicorns? Not unicorns yet, but soon to be. Well, that's my job. I don't know. I'm looking for those guys, right? So I'm going to share now some ideas of what are the next unicorns and how you can become one of them, possibly. So the kind of thesis for us for investment when we look at robotic companies is, okay, we believe that robots will replace humans in many, many tasks. In the case for history, from, you know, if you include the washing machine as a robot, definitely it happened, and it happened in manufacturing a lot. Robots will also work with humans, and the robots will also teach humans. So this kind of thesis. If we look at the recent news in robotics, so some things we noticed. This robotics company is a forklift robot called Valeo. French company, IPO'd in France and has a market cap of a bit less than 100 million euros. Auto, self-driving trucks, and Kongsberg, which I believe is it from Denmark? I think it is, might be. Okay, self-driving container ships, I think it's not the full thing that goes on the ocean, but the one that kind of goes to the container ship or something. So they plan to go all electric and autonomous by 2020. Maybe you noticed John Deere about Blue River, which is a kind of robotic system for basically removing weeds. So it doesn't drive the truck, but it does a lot of automated stuff. $200 million, this is how they evolved in 5 years. Quite interesting. Starship, automated delivery. Starship, yeah. Actually, you probably know it because one of the co-founders is used to be a co-founder of Skype.
Yeah,
I think it says. Yeah, that's right. Actually, the other guy is Janus Chris. Anyway, another one, I don't know if you heard about this one, you probably know Kiva, acquired by Amazon, has about 50,000 robots operating in warehouses now. This is another, it's a next generation warehouse robot called Grey Orange. Raised a total of $170 million. It's a company from India. And then a few more. You mentioned pizza, a delivery robot. This one actually makes the pizza on the go. So there's a driver and inside the robots make the pizza. Raised about $50 million. Automated kitchen called Spice. And then you could say autonomous convenience store called Bingo Box. This one is in China, very advanced for retail. There's also a few other news. Those two guys essentially kind of went bankrupt, more or less. Not fully, but close to. But there's also other news, like this company called MakeLock, a hack startup, one of our first investments, raised $80 million and is now shipping educational robots to about 20,000 schools around the world. What's interesting is that when you look at their robots, it's kind of hard to tell, it's a Chinese company. 70% of their business is outside China. Personally, I dislike these robots because I think they're kind of confusing the message about what robots are actually achieving today. The companions that try to create emotional connections, even this, probably the Sophia robot, I think they're sort of perpetuating some kind of old science fiction cliches that are not very accurate in the robotics industry today. So I'll share now some examples of robots that we think are actually going to do really well, and are not just sci-fi. So I mentioned MakeLock. So this is the founder of MakeLock. This is his first product that he put on Kickstarter about 5 years ago. He raised about $100,000. That was his first business funding. And now the company has grown quite a bit, about 500 staff, valuation actually over $300 million, servicing consumers and governments through schools. I asked myself the question, would we invest today if the same company was coming but now, 5-6 years later? And probably in this space, it's so crowded that probably we wouldn't invest now in the same company we invested in 5 years ago. Because 5 years ago, it was a great investment, and they did fantastic, and they scaled, and now it's fantastic success. But starting the same thing today would probably be a bad timing, because it's too crowded. 2014, another company called Cell Robotics. I don't know if you're familiar with this. I have a little movie here. I don't know if it's going to work. Oh, it didn't work. Try again. Okay, I don't know if you watched the Disney movie Big Hero 6 with the big white robot. So in that movie, there's also another robot that's combined of tiny, tiny things called microbots. And those are essentially modular robots. It's very advanced robotics research. Oops, actually, I don't have any image anymore. I don't know if it's the remote. Do you have it on the computer? Okay. It's here. Okay. I don't see. No. It's gone. Okay. So that's what they created, a team from Peking University. Modular robots. And we're like, okay, fantastic. It's really amazing, really advanced research. But what to do with it? What is it? What is it for? And they said, well, we want to promote education. We think modular robots are great for that. So they try to make it into a consumer product. When I visited labs in Switzerland, I met guys doing research in the same field. For two modules, it was costing them 3,000 euros to make just two. And to do something usable, we're not quite sure what it would be used for. They wanted to do like modular furniture. You can just imagine the price of modular furniture. Just two elements cost 3,000 euros. Those guys managed to make a product at about $500, which is still very expensive for consumers. They tried a Kickstarter, didn't work so well, and they tried to look for a market. And I thought that, okay, well, maybe it's great research, but it's not finding a market. Eventually, after a while, I discussed with them again, and I asked them, okay, how's the business? And they said, well, business is actually pretty good now. I said, really? Like, are you selling your robots for $500 to consumers? Let's say, oh, no, that didn't work. No, we switched to totally the business. We tested it in schools. And the schools realized that with a robot like this, you can actually spend all the time of the class teaching actual robotics, whereas when you use the Lego Mindstorms, no offense to Denmark, you actually spend a lot of time assembling and not so much doing robotics stuff. So as a result, students learn a lot faster. So the schools are totally fine paying lots of money to buy those things, and they have huge budgets, particularly in China, where the government is giving budgets to every province and every school to buy STEM tools. So they said, we stopped selling for $500. Now we sell for tens of thousands of dollars packages to schools, and there's lots of tools. So now the company, so what we learned is that going from lab to market is kind of hard if you don't have a clear customer in mind. And finding a market, B2C, B2B, B2G, sometimes requires quite a bit of trying. Would we invest today? I'm not so sure, because today I think we would have a more critical eye. Even though they're doing well, I think we would be very hesitant to invest until they prove they actually have a market and demand for the product. Another company, this one much easier to understand, that's kind of their first prototype, cleaning robot for commercial spaces. Here you can see the various generations of products. The founder is a team from Canada. This is Army of Robots. I have a little video here in the Singapore airport of the robot going around. What I think is absolutely remarkable here is that the robot's doing the job and nobody cares. And I think that's the success, is that this is one of the very first autonomous cleaning machines and nobody stops to look at it because it's not designed to, and it's just doing its job and it's accepted immediately. People are like, okay, big Roomba, what's the deal, right? That's actually very new. So this company is also doing well. This is probably one of the latest products. What's interesting about them is that the success is due not only to the engineering talent, but also to the fact that being based in Canada is an advantage. Canada has a high talent to entrepreneurs ratio. It means there's not too many entrepreneurs grabbing the talent. So when you try to hire, you can actually find really good people for not too expensive price, which is not the same in Silicon Valley. Also, the government has a lot of subsidies for R&D, which lower the cost further. And then being in Canada, they have access to US market and also a very global mindset, because they know that the local market is not enough. Interestingly, the founders are two engineers, so they're very, very technical, not very sales, marketing people. So I asked them, how did you get your first customers? And they said it was kind of an accident. We went to a trade show, we showed our thing, and then some people got really excited, and some guys in Singapore, some guys in Australia, and we started business this way. So it's also kind of highlighting for us the necessity for founders to go, get out there and be in front of potential customers, even if it's not really what you're most comfortable with. So today they have about 100 staff, which is quite significant for a robotics company, most of them engineers. It's a totally B2B company. Would we invest in this company now? Probably, because no strong competitor has really emerged. So maybe we would still invest, even like 4 years later, the same company. I'll go a bit more quickly about some other examples. OpenTrans, company doing a lab robot. So this is for automating pipetting in the biotech labs. So the founder is actually a veteran from the biotech industry. What's interesting about them is that initially they targeted big labs. He thought, okay, this is much cheaper machine than the giant machine. It's much easier to use. Every lab could have lots of those for each lab tech. It would save them a lot of time. As it turns out, the big labs were not so interested. So we told them, why don't you try, there's a kind of a trend of biotech at home and this kind of maker movement in biotech. Why don't you try Kickstarter for a lab robot for $5,000? So they did that. They raised about $100,000, but they also discovered new markets. They discovered that there were university labs and biotech, a lot of biotech startups that were very interested in the machine. And that actually became the primary market when they started. Not the big labs they initially thought. Today they're doing really well. They raised $10 million. They're doing quite well. That's fun. It's interesting to see that even for them, with a veteran in the industry, the market they accessed at the beginning were not the one they expected. they also were really fast at getting to market because coming to Shenzhen, their product is actually, you know, pretty simple in terms of hardware. It's kind of 3D gantry. It's like a, even simpler than a 3D, like FDM 3D printer. So they could make a first product quite quickly at a very good price. Doing it in China means that they had really low cost. And because of the low cost and because of the high value, they could price based on value rather than cost. If you price based on cost, maybe you price, you know, two times your cost, three times your cost, price based on value, as much as people already pay. There was a good margin, so they could even ship from China and get it in the hands of customers really quickly. Recently, in a conversation with another company, they told me that they moved the R&D from Europe to China because of the faster iterations they could do there. The person had this interesting phrase saying that China is the future of industrial R&D just because you can do the prototyping so much faster. And also, if you have industrial customers, a lot of them are in China. So would we invest now in this company? Probably still yes, because, again, no other customer. Totally makes sense as a product. Another one, very quickly, Symbio Robotics. Guys came from Willow Garage, the inventor of Robot OS, ROS.